I also need to give a thanks first to Jack Granith of the Bonner Springs Library, who originally called us to propose the conversation, to Diana Weaver, Laura Carroll, who created a resource list that's going to be shared with you later, to Cindy McGuire, and all of the librarians who have been involved in this effort. And it is my pleasure to introduce Sharon Moreland Center. She is the director of the Linwood Community Library District Number 1 in Southern Leavenworth County and spokesperson for the library's co-sponsoring tonight's program with the museum and memorial.
Hi, good evening, everybody. As Laura said, my name is Sharon. I'm the director at Linwood. Linwood is one of the 7 libraries in Northeast Kansas that's sponsoring this program with Laura at the National World War I Museum and with Dr. Nancy Bristow, author and historian, and journalist Rimsie McConiga from the Platte County Citizen. In 2019, these libraries worked together and presented a program called One Book, Many Neighbors. So when the Kansas Leadership Center, in association with Climate Plus Energy Project, they asked us to work with them on the program Kansas Beats the Virus. So we jumped at it. We put our heads together and we decided we wanted to stick with what we know and share information about how we've been here before. So on behalf of the public libraries of Atchison, Basehor, Bonner Springs, Leavenworth, Lansing, Linwood, and Tonganoxie, I want to say thank you for being with us tonight to discuss the 1918 flu and what we can learn from it that might be applicable today. For the deep divers and the folks that are curious, we've put together a book list of fiction and nonfiction titles that you might be interested in. I'm going to share that in chat when I'm done talking. And also, you can please visit the Leavenworth and Atchison websites. They have pulled together fascinating local history tidbits and pictures and articles. And I think some of the slides that I've seen are also pulled from the Bonner Springs Library's Kansas Room collection. So we really hope that you enjoy tonight's discussion. We're excited with this partnership that we've got going. And thank you very much and enjoy.
Sharon, thank you so much. We really appreciate it. Now I'd like to introduce I'd like to bring to the proverbial stage here both Rimsie and Dr. Nancy Bristow for our conversation about the fact that we might have been here before. Thank you to all of you who have who were part of the RSVPs. You all gave us 250 amazing questions to answer. And we are gonna do our best to address some of them in broad strokes to begin with. And then really kind of run through and do as many deep dive questions as we possibly can at the end. At the end of our conversation. And again, I wanted to shout out to, there are people from across the United States, from Washington to Pennsylvania, hello, Texas, Virginia, California, Brooklyn, Nebraska, Georgia, KCMO, Olathe, Reno, everyone from the towns mentioned in your county libraries. Hello, Catherine Footer. Delighted that you're joining us from New York. And I think Rimsie is working her way into our space. And while she does, I think I know what the first question is going to be. So there we go, Rimsie. Fantastic. And I'm afraid you might still be muted.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. We're gonna start with the question, when, where, and how did the Spanish flu begin? And what caused it?
Nancy.
I'm gonna jump in really quick to just suggest that the name Spanish flu itself is a misnomer. This flu did not begin in Spain by any stretch of the imagination. In fact, it was called the Spanish flu by contemporaries because the nation, the world, I should say, was at war. World War I was underway. Spain was not a belligerent nation, so they didn't have wartime censorship. So as country after country after country succumbed to this flu attack, they hid the information. They didn't talk about how many citizens were sick because they wanted to look strong in the midst of this conflict, except for Spain. And Spain told the story. So they got blamed for the flu when it's far more likely that we should be calling it the American flu. In fact, that's right. Your neighbors there in Kansas.
Wow.
Right. And many of them actually say that I think it's the first reported case happened at Camp Funston. And this is what's now known as Fort Riley in Kansas. There's also a lot of scholars who might disagree. They might say, you know what, it's one of the first reported cases coming from this space that you see in front of you. But there may be some evidences that show that it could have started earlier. An earlier variant might have occurred in the UK, in France. I know that there's one scholar who suggests China. But the United States, this is the place that we can look at. And I have to say, we just pulled this out of our archive at the National World War I Museum and Memorial, and kind of gives me the heebie-jeebies right now. But you can see how all of these people are really closely packed together for a football game. I believe that's going to be 1918. So really right before you have this spread. So this is right before some of this, or kind of right as this is all starting to occur. And so you can see, we all know that kind of being in close proximity and the like, you certainly are sharing air and germs and all of that other sort of good stuff that may or may not have been as clear 100 years ago. But you end up having really the first reported cases happening. And this is a picture of and this was the picture from our event itself. This is a picture of the medical space at Camp Funston. But we're right in the midst of a war. You have these individuals who don't really understand the full extent to what is going to be happening, just how contagious it is, how quickly it's moving. It's in many ways, back for us in the United States, kind of that feeling of being those first couple weeks in March and February, right? We don't necessarily know, and people are all kind of packed together and they are moving out from the middle of the Midwest. Again, you can kind of see how all of a sudden you have this transporting of a virus. You've got Americans who are landing in Russia, Americans who are serving in China. So it's really easy to see how it becomes this global, very quickly becomes this global pandemic. It is in many ways similar to the type of travel that we have had, that we have in the modern era, really is the type of mass movements that are occurring at the time.
One thing I would add to that, in case it may become relevant as we talk about how they dealt with it, is that those first cases in Kansas, people aren't aware that there is a global pandemic about to happen, right? Which is not unlike how we were when we were first hearing about Wuhan. But it is that mobilization of the troops that then takes it from the US over to Europe. And this is happening in the spring and summer. And it's when it arrives at the Western Front that people start really noticing that something's happening. And then in late August, there is a shift in the virus, and that's when you get the really explosive illness that we associate with the pandemic. And it's almost as if it's already a second wave, but the first wave had moved through without the same kind of severity.
All right. Okay. What were the public health measures back then, and were they as politicized as they are today?
Oh, that's a really great question. And I saw some of the questions that some of you asked, and they were incredibly poignant as well. I think some of you have asked things like, how did they cope with the stress? Really some really good, you've got some great questions in there. I will going to show some pictures of the era. And then Nancy, if you want to kind of speak to some of, you know, some of this here in just a second. But I want to start actually with a letter from the collection. We expected to be quarantined upon our arrival. It was unexpected that they had as many deaths as they did on the ships on their way over. And it was something that would not happen again. People did kind of quickly learn about the disease, about the virus. They tried to take measures to the best of the knowledge that they had at the time. It's the same thing that we have been experiencing as well, right? So they started off educating with the best information that they had available. Sneeze, but don't scatter, right? That's really not the same version as this at all. but that's the point, right? It's telling you not to scatter. So it is almost 100 years ago, the exact same thing that we tell our elementary school kids to do today. There's some not so great advice, things like onion soup or other remedies that may not have necessarily been so helpful. But again, you've got, if you take a look a little bit later in the second paragraph here, there seems to be no sure method of preventing the influenza, but there's no doubt that overcrowding in stuffy billets, promiscuous coughing, and sneezing are two of the most important causes. Feel free to use the word promiscuous coughing as often as you want over the next week, and think fondly of us and how the language was used back in the day. Now, every man should see to it that he has his allotted floor space, plenty of ventilation, right? Some of these questions that we look today. And lastly, when you get ill, go see the medical officer. And this is one of my favorite photographs. This is courtesy of the National Archives. That question that many of you had about masks. This is the 39th Regiment on its way to France. They are going through Seattle. Each one of them had a mask that had been provided by the Seattle chapter of the Red Cross. And folks are trying to figure out, I believe this is a picture from KU Hospital, their base hospital. They're trying to figure out what's causing this. We have a whole series of x-rays and the like. I did not add those in specifically, but doctors are really trying their very best to get to the root causes, what's spreading it and the like. You can again see some of those specific ways that folks are trying to address the public health issue. Nancy, do you want to add more?
I think you've nailed what's so important here is that on the one hand, they can't see the virus. They don't have the technology. So we're in a much more advantaged position because we could identify the virus immediately. They did not have the technology, but they did understand germ theory. And so they were operating sort of on faith that these measures should help, but they couldn't tell whether they were either. So it was really a tough struggle, I think, to get people to continue to follow these restrictions, but it was very much the same ones. Closures, right? Not allowing public meetings, public masking, quarantining of the sick, educating of the public, more air circulation. It's just down the line, almost identical to the measures that we're taking today. It's just that we know, because we have their data, in fact, as well as data that we've produced this time around, we know that these measures work, whereas they're having to use them kind of on faith and on belief in what the leadership is asking for. And that's where the politicization part comes in, I think is so interesting here, which is, I would argue that it's not in any way as politicized, because in this iteration of a terrible global pandemic, in our nation at least, it was politicized very much around party politics and around elections. So that, you know, to wear a mask or not to wear a mask was to make a political statement of sorts. There was nothing like that in 1918. What you do see, though, is public resistance nevertheless. At the beginnings of the pandemic, people are anxious to do anything they're told in hopes of staying healthy. But as they realize that people around them are continuing to get sick and to die, there's kind of a loss of faith in the leadership because they can't know, they don't have the idea, for instance, of flattening the curve that we can throw around. And so when new waves come around and many communities go through a really serious wave in the fall of 1918, and then it's followed by another wave during the winter, spring, it's much harder to get people to cooperate in that next wave, because like, wait a minute, we did what you said, we're all still getting sick, I am over the whole masking thing.
Yeah,
so that's where you end up, right, with the anti-masking group in San Francisco.
Yeah. To the person who asked quite specifically the question, did the US population behave themselves any better before than they are this go around? I feel like Dr. Bristow just answered your question. And thank you for writing it that way, because it did make me laugh. And you know, it's part of just our everyday, it is part of our everyday experience. And for the person who asked, how do you address a person not wanting to wear PPE, about the importance of doing so based on past history? So we've got a little bit here, and hopefully we have some more for you here in just a bit. Someone else also asked a really good question, not only about did healthcare workers wear it, and the answer is definitely yes, but also about the death tolls to healthcare workers. And if you can still see it, if you've got a large enough screen, if you take a look in the kind of left-hand side and you see that woman with her arms crossed, you can actually see how thin that that mask is. What we benefit from is that we know the importance of having a thicker mask, not being able to blow a candle out from behind it and the like. A lot of the masks that were provided and that people were working with at the time were actually made of kind of a gauzy material, so they weren't as effective as they are today. It was a great question about the death toll for nurses. I can say that one of, in our museum and memorial, your national World War I Museum and Memorial, there's a listing of the dead from Kansas City in Memory Hall. And it's kind of that kind of greater Kansas City area. And we do have one nurse who we know died of the flu, who is listed on that wall. She was taking part in giving a humanitarian way. And she didn't die of combat, but because she was there in those spaces. So those deaths absolutely are part of that sacrifice for the war effort. So it also gets a little bit complicated for some of the other questions that come later about death toll as well.
Okay. Overall, how do you think the two pandemics compare? And was 1918 overall worse than 2020?
I mean, there's so much to be said here. Do you want me to start off, Laura, and then toss it to you?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so first you're dealing with two different viruses, which is important to notice. And in 1918, you were dealing with a level of exposure and infection. The infection rates are roughly a quarter of the population, or a third of the population worldwide. Something like 500 million people are infected with this disease. So it's an extraordinary number. And then it also has a high mortality rate at about 2.5% in the United States, which is higher than what we seem to be suffering from COVID, though I think those statistics are very unclear still, as are the statistics from 1918. One thing that they had an advantage in 1918 is that you weren't able to infect others before you were symptomatic. There's none of this asymptomatic problem that we're wrestling with, which probably helped in terms of trying to keep those who were sick away from those who are healthy. So in terms of the virus itself, you're dealing with something that's quite different. And they do lose 675,000 Americans out of a population of 100 million. So we're not yet at the same death toll, and we're a much larger nation today. So in terms of sheer numbers, at this point, it was actually worse, and it was compressed into a tighter time period. Almost all of the death takes place in a roughly 4, 5, 6 month period, as opposed to ours being stretched over a longer period. But then in terms of how it is sort of how people make their way through it, there are so many similarities. It's absolutely awful, frankly, as a historian to watch. So a lack of federal leadership in terms of the person in the White House in both cases. Woodrow Wilson never says a word about the pandemic. And we know that the former president of the White House in our own time, you know, gave a lot of really misleading and misinformation around the pandemic that wasn't very helpful. In both cases, without that leadership from the very top, without any sort of federal program, you have a scattershot approach in both cases where city to city, county to county, state to state, there's so much variation. And what you want most of all in a pandemic is a unified approach, not to say that each community wouldn't be at different phases because we're dealing with different moments of the pandemic, but that you should have a shared plan of attack because viruses don't care about state lines. They don't care about county lines. We have lacked in both cases that kind of coordination from above. Another thing that I think is really important just to remember is the most important thing is the same about both, which is the main story is trauma and suffering and loss of life. And that is shared across these, you know, the century. It was just as traumatic and just as horrific for people to lose their loved ones then as it is now. And criminally, I would argue today, as in those days, that is inequitably distributed in our society. And that for me is frankly criminal in 2021, that we could have been at a place 100 years later where those same kinds of racial divides and the same costs, for instance, of poverty would still be so blatant. But those are the things that immediately pop to mind for me in terms of similarities that are really marked despite the difference in the virus itself.
Okay.
I would say for me, right, being a curator at a museum, I've got to always go back to the primary sources. I'll read this out loud in case it's not clear on your screen. This is from the highest medical person in the land, warning to the country that the influenza epidemic is by no means ended and that all possible precautions against the disease should be taken, was issued tonight by Surgeon General Blue of the Public Health Service. Reports received by the service show a recurrence of the disease practically from one end of the country to another. And in his statement, Dr. Blue advised the closing of public schools on the first sign of the reappearance of the epidemic. I mean, I feel like that's almost, I mean, that is maybe not the exact words of Dr. Fauci, but there's a real sense of this exact same sentiment that is also just happening right now. We are in a very similar place. You can see here in a letter from Walter Shaw to his mother in Bonner Springs. He says, it's actually, I think, vice versa there. The ban is still on everything. The influenza is better, although quite a few deaths have occurred here. I think school will begin next week. Also churches and picture shows as everything has been closed for a month. We have this real similarity. This isn't new, that question about do we close schools? Do we close churches? You know, what happens economically to those picture shows and the like? And Nancy, I think you brought up earlier that when you used to teach this before this year, you would say, can you imagine closing a school for 2 weeks?
Well, and of course, that's one of the differences that it's so difficult to know what to do because you don't know what's going to happen next. But this issue about closing schools, they were talking about something that might be in their community for 2 or 3 or 4 weeks. And here we are almost on a year anniversary of when my university, for instance, sent me home and said, you go learn how to use your computer because you're teaching virtually on Monday, which I found on a Saturday night. They were dealing with a more confined time period, but they didn't have computers. So, you know, we are able to stay in touch by way of computer. I've been teaching online for almost a year now, but we've been able to continue some education in a way that they didn't have that option. So it sounds crazy to say I feel lucky, but in some ways, I think the technology that we have has been a real bonus. And also for those who are really sequestered as individuals, my own mother is 91. So she can't be out and about, but as soon as I get off here, my next stop is the family Zoom that we do every night, which again, I'm so grateful in some ways for some of the technology that we have that they had to work without through the pandemic of 1918. And I love your point that this issue about the churches and schools, These were absolutely hot issues then, just as they are today. There was disagreement about whether or not to close things. There were disagreements about when you should open them. And it was often the same players that were taking the same position. So there's so much resonance. It's really fascinating sometimes to watch us. And again, I don't think it was difficult to decide what to do in those days, and it's difficult to decide what to do today as well.
It gives us a historic empathy. I think many of us, likely not you, as you've written an entire book on this, but as a former classroom teacher and the like, all of a sudden you can really identify with this time frame in a much more visceral and a much more empathetic way, because you can see where we do just make some of these exact same choices. And for many of you who are joining us, you are asking the same question: what is it that we could learn from history? And some of them are these things of us trying to do our best. You know, when and where do you wear masks, or how do you handle? You know, what are the sacrifices that individuals and communities are willing to make? At the end of the day, that really comes down, that is one of the big questions that we end up asking, that they were asking back then, and that we're asking ourselves today. In San Francisco, they had one of the most stringent ordinances. Their city board of health recommended against using streetcars at peak times to avoid crowds, rigorous personal hygiene, all services to be canceled or held outside, wearing face masks. They later enforced it as a finable ordinance. They did something similar in Seattle as well. You can actually see a court that is being held outdoors because they were encouraging folks to do that. It is also in San Francisco that they had a scene of a pretty significant anti-mask protest. So if you're looking for similarities, right here.
And one of the things that's really interesting about San Francisco is they had masks, and then things had gotten better and they quit wearing them at one point. But during that first time period, they still had the mask ordinance in place, and the mayor and the chief of public health were spotted in a boxing match without their masks on. And it completely undercut the whole masking effort in the city. And it goes back to the ways in which sort of modeling public health, if there are restrictions, then having leadership model those can make a difference in the public's response to whether or not they feel compelled then also to follow the rules. And San Francisco, it didn't help them. They went on to have a much higher death rate, for instance, than Seattle had had.
Mm-hmm. Let's see if we've got a couple of other images here. Again, back 100 years ago as today, on your left-hand side, you actually see an advertisement for what we would now refer to as bone broth, saying that it's going to keep you from getting infected. So certainly there's that element of capitalism that we see in other aspects of our lives, and journalism as well. Image here, courtesy of Bonner Springs Library. Cannot say when the schools will be opened up again. Everything depends on what course the flu epidemic takes. New cases on decline. I feel like that's a similar headline that you might be seeing in other spaces today. So, you know, those feelings, that intensity, trying to find that balance, that is exactly what people were doing 100 years ago and are encountering again today. At the National World War I Museum and Memorial, we have a really wonderful teacher resource that was put together by our school programs manager, Cherie Kelly. And we're actually showing you a part of the answer guide. We give it as a sample because we are still right in the midst of COVID-19, but asking students to kind of do a comparison between 1918 from history books, and then taking a look at whatever your current events say at the time that you might be using this, and doing this comparison between the past and the present. But the nice thing about really good teacher resources is that they're helpful no matter your age. So I'm going to really quickly go through some of these different comparisons. And again, this was even crafted prior to getting all of your questions here together. But we'll give you a link about where to grab this. And Nancy, I've got a question for you about waves of infection later on, I think. Whether or not you would say that it's 3 or 4. Actually, I'll just ask you that question right now.
You know, I'm not sure. I'm not an epidemiologist. I won't pretend to be one. I have family, that are actually medical health professionals. So I have to be really careful not to say anything silly. It's hard to know. What we do know is that there is a fourth, there is a period in early 1920 when many Americans do die of influenza and pneumonia. And two of my great grandparents are among them. So I had always assumed that they were part of the flu pandemic until I found out they died in 1920. I thought, well, maybe they weren't. Howard Markell at the University of Michigan suggested to me that there may be sort of a fourth wave that happens then that winter of 1919, 1920, or it's the first wave of seasonal flu. And one of the questions I know we'll get to is whatever happened to the Spanish flu? Well, it's still around. The descendants, many of our seasonal flus today are actually descendants of that virus from 1918. And what happens is it shifts again as it had in the fall of 1918. It does it again, so it becomes less deadly and less infectious and sort of peters out, but it doesn't disappear. It continues to be a part of the influenza world, so to speak.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next question. How did the news report about the 1918-19 influenza? How different was it then than now?
I think Nancy already gave one of the best examples, which is, again, that Spain did some wonderful journalism. And that's incredibly important, as Rimsie can attest, the importance of good journalism in the world. And they wanted to get that information out there. In Spain, I think it was part of their royal family that had come down with it, and they felt it was imperative, that it was and it was kind of their moral responsibility to let the rest of the world know that this thing was occurring. And that is not necessarily the case for other spaces that had greater censorship on their newspapers and the like. The United States doesn't have the same level of censorship as what's happening in Britain or in France. So that's the first big answer on that one. Nancy, I think you've got more.
Well, no, it's one of the things that's really remarkable is, and I'm often asked this question, that did they just not have as good of information? And it's true that the information traveled much more slowly, right? There wasn't a 24/7 news cycle, but even the smallest towns would often have one or two weeklies. So everybody, pretty much most Americans in the contiguous states would have had access to a newspaper, and it would include international news. It would tell about, you know, how many people are dying in Germany and England and what happened to the Queen's sister. And it would include what's happening in Deer Creek and what's happening down the road at White Plain. And then next to that, what's happening, right? It would have the really localized stories about, you know, so-and-so's daughter who moved away to Maryland seems to have passed from the flu. Farmer Jones down the street was sick and his three children are also ill. It was really closely documented in the newspapers with a lot of really terrific information. It's before everything was digitized, newspapers were one of the most important sources for gaining access into how, you know, literally what happened. And that the newspaper reporting has been really important and influential in our understanding. And again, because people still had news, it just didn't travel quite as quickly, but it was pretty good news, well done news, I should say. The news was very bad, obviously.
That's true. You know, we've got, again, and these are images thanks to our library partners who are partners within this program this evening. Right, you've got some really good examples here. No program for combating the flu. I think we showed you that one earlier. But really taking a look at the different levels of reporting as we're going through the number of claims. Pardon me. There we go. Right, so you can see in some ways that similarity because you get the daily update just like we do today, right? So Topeka, still in the clutches of the flu epidemic, continues to spread. 180 new cases December 2nd, December 3rd, 200 new cases reported yesterday. So you have this same level of pretty expansive amount of information that you can get and report in within 24 hours, which in some ways isn't bad. Having a day to be able to process that information is not necessarily a bad thing. And really, to support what Nancy said, there's a lot of importance, and in some ways we're losing a real resource in information when we're losing our smaller newspapers, when they might be getting bought out and the like. We've got, you can see different examples. These are not necessarily all small newspapers, by the way. In case you're joining us from outside of the Missouri, Kansas area, let me make that part clear for you here.
Yeah. And you can notice too, all that there's constant conversation about what are the rules? What are you allowed to do? Should we, right? Thinking of such a move soon about closing the state, a constant conversation and controversy really about what public health measures should be taken, when should they be taken, how long should they last, when can they be lifted?
Mm-hmm. And you can see right here, speaking to what Nancy was talking about earlier about this idea of a potentially a fourth wave, right? This is February of 1920, and still how it's affecting communities as that's going along. And some of you have asked some questions about the globally, how is that, what did that look like? Here's another really good example of from the Scotland Herald, right, of encouraging folks to do what they needed to do to try to stop the spread of the pandemic.
Okay, and how did the flu pandemic end in 1920?
Well, as I mentioned before, so influenza is a virus that moves very quickly. It's one of the reasons, right, that it's so difficult to get the flu shot right, because they have to decide ahead of time which virus they think will be most important so that they can produce this vaccine for us. By the time flu season comes around, that virus may have already drifted off into some other virus and the shot won't be effective at all. So it's a virus that's constantly changing, and that's what happens, is it continues to change. And at some point, either, you know, with the end of the winter wave in 1919 or the end of the winter wave in 1920, it drifts enough to no longer be so infectious and so deadly, because its interest, I'm often criticized for anthropomorphizing viruses. I can't help myself. They did not have motivation. The one thing viruses do need to do, though, is to replicate themselves, which means they need victims. But they don't care whether the victim gets really sick. They don't care whether the victim dies. They just need to be able to reproduce themselves. And so at some point, it drifts enough that it just ceases to be a pandemic scale virus. But it, as I say, did persist, and there's a wonderful piece by Jeffrey Taubenberger, who is one of the, I can put it in the chat, he's one of the people who mapped the genome of the 1918 virus. And he has a great piece called The Once and Future Virus. And it's about the ways in which the 1918 virus really is still with us. It never went away fully.
Muted. We've got a really nice quote here about the influenza waves in Kansas. There were no waves in the 1920 outbreak. The disease quickly reached its peak, declined, and disappeared, but there was no armistice to celebrate as well. So whether or not, so this comes from a Kansas State Board of Health epidemiologist, but you can see how this actually contradicts a little bit of some of the conversation, some of the things that you were seeing a little bit earlier, there as well. So in Kansas specifically, thanks to the Kansas State Library, we've got a very specific outline of deaths and death toll. And I think, did you have more, I apologize, did you have more on that particular question, Nancy?
No, but someone has just put in the chat, and I want to call attention to it, that there's a thing online called the Influenza Encyclopedia. It was created by scholars at the University of Michigan, and they've done stories on 50 different American cities. And given that we have an audience from all over the country, you may be interested in what happened in New York or what happened in Louisiana or what happened in Oregon. And as I say, 50 different cities, they have a multi-paragraph story, sort of an overview of what happened. And then they have a timeline, so you can look literally day by day by day. And then they have links to lots and lots of newspaper articles from that particular city's press. So depending on where you're from, you may find that a fun place to go to see what happened in your community during the pandemic. Again, it's only 50 cities, but it's an incredible resource put together by really good scholars. So they've done a lot of the work for you. If you want to go find out about your own, if not your hometown, perhaps you can find a town somewhere near you.
And I would be remiss if I didn't at this moment also say, depending upon where you're joining us from, take a look at your local libraries. There are a lot of incredible resources there. Reach out to a librarian. They are superheroes of information and can point you into some really good spaces. Always, of course, feel free to reach out to us as well and to our Evergens Research Center. But wherever you are located, there is likely just a treasure trove of information. There may not be memorials to that. As a matter of fact, I'm fairly certain there are not a lot of flu pandemic memorials around the United States. And something that makes this unique is that this pandemic is layered on top of this destructed, horrific, catastrophic global war. And so sometimes, and I'll say this as a caveat for some of the questions that may come up, on the real specificity of exact numbers or the like, it's hard to tell sometimes and where to put, and you know, where do you put a number when you were serving for your nation and you die of the flu. So there's some difficulty with exact statistics. And then at the same time, there's a whole other layer of just loss that occurs in this time frame.
Okay. And what are the most important things do you think that we've learned since the 1918 pandemic?
Nancy, that's all.
That is such a great question. And I'll admit here, my own bias is clear that I regret that I think there are things we didn't learn that led to, like, I think we haven't learned to take seriously prevention and preparation for this kind of thing. We knew there would be a pandemic of some sort. We expected it to be influenza, frankly, but we weren't adequately prepared. And we haven't put sufficient resources, and again, this is my own opinion, but my sense is we really need to put more resources into preparation. So for instance, a more robust system for developing vaccines where you could use, for instance, the national laboratories, a better preparation plan locally, nationally, and globally. And I think that in part, that comes from lessons that went unlearned, that we really didn't change our public health processes in the country hardly at all. And many countries did, but the United States did not. But one of the things I think we did learn and that's super important is all the scientific research that's been done since. So we can see viruses now and we know how the virus works. And as a result, we have a vaccine, which is just a stunning accomplishment and how quickly it was done beyond anyone's guess, which again, is a stunning accomplishment of the federal government for which I'm deeply grateful. Another thing I think we learned was as a result of what they went through, we know some things about what to do. Someone asked a question, in fact, about the taking care of patients. We're so much better prepared medically to manage the disease now, and that's saving a lot of lives. We have antibiotics now, which they didn't have in 1918. So many of the secondary infections that people died from in 1918, like bacterial pneumonia, we can actually deal with now. So scientifically, we've advanced so many stages beyond what they all were hoping for and dreaming of in 1918. So much of that we've actually accomplished, but we didn't change a lot of other things related to how we provide healthcare and how we deal with the public healthcare system in the country. And again, that's a very politically charged question, I recognize. So I'll stop there.
And I'll pick it up by saying neither Nancy nor I are medical professionals. And somebody asked the question, what's our best advice for staying healthy today? And I would say it is listening to your medical professional, not your historian, as far as your health is concerned, though we are a lot of fun to listen to. A couple of folks who you might be interested in following, Michael Olsterholm from the University of Minnesota and Powell Kazanjian are both epidemiologists who do work in this area, and then they also focus in on history as well. Dr. Kazanjian actually had a lecture recorded 2 years ago called Influenza's Threat Then and Now. Couldn't recommend it more highly. It's also terrifying when you get to the last part. I sat through it the first time live, and then you really appreciate just how spot on Dr. Kazanjian was. So you can find that at our YouTube channel, which is if you go to theworldwar.org in the upper right-hand corner, you can really kind of delve into a little bit more of that. What could we have learned from the science perspective there at that particular lecture? Just type in flu. If you go to our page, theworldwar.org, in the upper right-hand corner, there's a YouTube link. Click on that, a little YouTube symbol. Click on that, just type in flu in our channel. It'll pop up. That's one of those for me as well. I spend a lot of time with letters. One of my favorites, and I'm afraid I'm not going to quote it correctly or directly right now, is actually it's a wonderful, I believe his name is Ernest McKay, might be how it's pronounced. And it's just this wonderful series of letters that he's writing back and forth to his wife and daughter, and he serves overseas, and then he comes back, and they're debating whether or not she should come and visit over the holidays. And he literally starts off this letter of, I'm not sure that you should do this. If you do, be sure to get the best car that you can, wear a veil. It's just wonderful, and that we have these letters. So I would say one of those key things to that we can learn is how important it is to tell the people we love that we love them, and to be sure to engage in that. I would also say, kind of from a museum perspective, keeping those diaries, capturing your personal experiences. That's how all of this informs, right? All of these other books, the book that Nancy wrote, right? All of this comes from these personal experiences. And as we're losing some of our amazing local newspapers, where, as they might be bought out by other spaces, we don't have the access to that. And certainly there are other spaces and technological places for you to be sharing that, but take the time to share that information and the like. I think that's another really important thing.
And if your local historical society or like local library or archive is doing a collection and invites you to tell your story of the pandemic, don't hesitate. If you've got a story to tell, that's one of the things that's been really uplifting for me, is seeing the real attention to getting the story recorded during this pandemic, precisely because we realize how many voices we didn't have from 1918, and trying to avoid that this time. So on my little island where I live, there, the Historical Society, until we got into the most recent spike, we were doing oral histories and trying to hit, you know, first the medical providers, people who are doing testing, and then who's working at the grocery stores, and on through the school kids, trying to get all those voices that, you know, 100 years from now will be really helpful as people are trying to make sense of it from the future. So tell your story.
Okay. And are there any additional resources that you would recommend for people who want to find out as much as possible about the pandemics?
Absolutely. And I'm gonna kick this one off. And I would say that one of you was kind enough to even, Harrison Manlove, you were the person, if you are still watching this, thank you for telling us that this was a great resource and that you watched it in preparation for this. We have a resource called How World War I Changed America. You can find it at wiichangedus.org. We've got a whole series of 7-minute or less videos, as well as teacher resources. Videos, podcasts, lesson plans, primary source stuff that you can assign for them to do from their home if you would like. That is available. There's also, and I believe this is what Sharon mentioned at the beginning, there's a lovely resource list that includes fiction, nonfiction, that is there on nextkansas.org. And it is there listed under the We've Been Here Before suggested reading list. One of you asked, did the flu influence the arts as much as the war did? Really good question. It's difficult to really pull apart because those two events layer on top of each other. I would say that certainly the war influenced some writers in a very different way. You've got, right, Winnie the Pooh, Tolkien, C.S. Lewis, all of these folks who really spend some time and their writing is in some way a way for them to process their experiences as well. But you've got some wonderful things to be looking at there for in that spectacular reading list. So do take a look. If you are in and around the Kansas area, and thank you so much for emailing me about this, take a look at Pandemic on the Prairie. It's a podcast about the intersection of public health, cultural history, and war in Kansas. You can see the web address right up there. Nancy, if I'm not mistaken, you're one of the first, you're one of the first episodes.
Yeah. And I believe John Barry is also part of it. And I suspect several other scholars involved with it. They were doing real nice work.
Yeah, so take a look at that. Also, take a look at Nancy's book, American Pandemic, The Lost World of the 1918 Influenza Epidemic. We've also talked about a couple of other things as well that I think have been listed in, we've been trying to fill that into chat. Hopefully you are getting that in the Facebook Live chat as well. Nancy, other resources you suggest?
Yeah, I popped my two favorite pieces that if you wanna just get a sense of the lived experience of it, in some ways there's two semi-autobiographical novellas that are just terrific. Mm-hmm. And I put them both in the chat. One is William Maxwell's They Came Like Swallows. He would go on to be a very well-known writer and editor of The New Yorker for years and years. And he was a child when, and I won't, no spoiler, he was a child when his family faced the pandemic. I'll just say that. And he tells that story from the perspective of different family members. And it's a powerful, powerful, beautiful book. And then Catherine Ann Porter, who was a journalist at the time living in Denver, and she also had influenza, and she does a semi-autobiographical novella as well about her own illness and that of her beloved Adam. And it's all bound up with the war, and it's very effective on the sort of mental phase, the psychological complexity of the how hard it was on the patient in terms of what it did to their minds and how their minds worked. Those are my two, just my favorite pieces and great reads and not very long. And then there are lots of good scholarly books out there. Gina Collada, if you're interested in the search for the virus itself, her book Flu deals with that, and it's just a masterful piece. If you're interested in what happened in the military, especially given that it starts at a military camp and the camps are really hard hit by it, Carol Byerly has a very good book called Fever of War that deals with the pandemic in the ranks of the military for the US as well. And then Laura Spinney's Pale Horse, which is one of the newest books, came out for the 100th anniversary, and it's an international history. And again, really a beautifully done book by a very well-known international journalist. I think she hails from England, lives in Paris, and wrote this beautiful book that's just one of the newest books, I think, on the pandemic.
I am also, I have not had the opportunity to read these, but two other things that were suggested to me were Marilyn Holt. She wrote some great articles pertaining to the Spanish influenza for Kansas history. So take a look at that if you are looking more for the Kansas angle on this. Also, someone asked, or a couple of people actually asked some really good questions about orphans in and around this time frame. And we would specifically encourage you to take a look at Ellie Vance's thesis that she put out in 2019 on the Spanish influenza pandemic of 1918, a defining characteristic in the life and history of the American family. Also, if you are around the Kansas City area, we would encourage you to take a look at the Strawberry Hill Museum. They've got some really nice information about some things specific to our region.
Yeah. And one thing to be said about the orphans, it's a wonderful question, especially for this pandemic. One thing we didn't talk about was it was in one of your charts that COVID is taking especially the elderly, which is what we expect with this kind of illness. Influenza traditionally takes the very young and the very old, but this particular influenza, 50% of the deaths in the United States were people between the ages of 20 and 40, AKA parents. So huge numbers of orphaned children. My, as I say, my own grandfather lost his parents in a five day span between February 24th and February 29th. He lost two parents, a 15-year-old who goes from just being a kid with a family, and over the course of less than a week, becomes an orphan and an adult. I mean, it just, and he's one of literally thousands of young people to whom that happened. Good Lord, somebody just put in the chat, had talked to someone 104 years old who lost both of their parents on the same night. Can you even, oh my God.
And you guys can all see why I always enjoy having conversations with Dr. Nancy Bristow. So a couple of other questions that I see here, we've got just a moment or two. Has anyone studied the transfer of property and other assets that occurred because of the flu? There's a lot of really good economic questions that were asked. Nancy, do you by chance have a answer?
I don't. It's a wonderful question. And the issue around the economics of the pandemic and its aftermath are just now being studied with obviously significant interest. There were some early studies that suggested that the same communities that had low death rates also recovered economically more quickly, but this was very preliminary work. So I don't know if that's been borne out over the last few months with additional research or not, but the questions around the economics of this earlier pandemic, I think will be of even greater interest now. But no, I'm not well-schooled in that, I'll be honest. I'm even less of an economist than I am an epidemiologist.
Barb Jensen asked, what U.S. city fared the best, the fewest deaths from 1918, which also kind of begs the question, is there one that fared the worst?
The worst is probably Pittsburgh and or Philadelphia. Both have just disastrous, catastrophic experiences with it. And Philadelphia is always the story that gets told because they hold a Liberty Loan parade just as the pandemic is hitting them. And so like 3 days later, they have 600 plus new cases. It's the beginning of a terrible experience with the pandemic in Philadelphia. In part, that's not their fault. They were one of the really early cities. So in general, Western cities do better than Eastern cities because they have more time and they have the experiences of other cities to look at. Some of the cities that do really well, Milwaukee, Wisconsin does really well. They had a very, quote, progressive, as in the progressive era, public health system that they'd really developed over the preceding 10 or 15 years. So they were really well prepared for it, put a lot of measures in place and have a very low death rate. Seattle does very well. There's several cities in the West that do reasonably well. And then several cities in the East that, as I say, have just catastrophic experiences.
Mm-hmm. I'll answer a couple of other fast questions. And then if you're willing to stay on for just a few more bets, we can officially close, but stay on to answer a few more of the in-depth questions that we have here. Andrea asked, how were individuals with severe respiratory conditions treated since they couldn't wear a mask? I would say that in many cases, the masks weren't as, they just weren't made of the same material that they are today. So they weren't as effective, but also if someone had a really significant respiratory issue, that wouldn't necessarily have been a problem. I happen to think of that your question triggers something like gas sort of damage and things along that line. And most likely that's not somebody who would be going out and about and doing some of those other things. They wouldn't need to be, they wouldn't be out trying to, or being in those spaces, I think, with some of those ordinances. I could be wrong, and I really haven't delved into some of the protests of masks. Nancy, do you have more?
No, only that, again, because you were either sick or you, how can I put this? Those who are really sick, often you'll see that the caregivers are wearing masks, but the patients often are not. And I don't know the storyline behind that, but you're right, this is a respiratory illness. So the idea of putting a mask on people who are literally, if you're dying from the Spanish flu, you are drowning in your own bodily fluids. So breathing is so belabored that those people would not have generally been wearing masks, is my sense, at least from looking at the photographs. That's what the photographic record seems to say.
Jerrica asks, says it would be lovely to have a list of all the recommended readings mentioned in this program. We will do our best. to get those together. And I know that we have several librarians who are a part of this conversation here tonight. So I'm hopeful that someone has been tracking all of the different things that we have also just kind of thrown out along the way. And somewhere between the Leavenworth County Public Library, which is one of the spaces that is showcasing this on Facebook Live, as well as the National World War I Museum and Memorial Facebook page. We will certainly do our best sometime soon to get that information out there. All right, well, as it is 8:03, we want to officially thank all of you for being a part of our conversation. I think, Rimsie, are you available for just a few more minutes to
Yes.
ask more questions? Fabulous. Sure. Nancy, would you be willing?
Sure.
Okay,
sure.
Another family Zoom call coming.
They won't be surprised I'm often late.
To all of you who have joined us, thank you. The most valuable thing that you can share with us is your time. And we are so appreciative that you use your time to engage in conversations of history and on the enduring impact of World War I, those lessons that we can learn, because in some ways we have been here before. And there are things that have occurred in the past that can help inform and create gracious, interesting, funny conversations for the present and inform our science and how we keep moving forward. And I apologize, I keep hitting my keyboard. I also want to say thank you to our libraries for whom I will not name all of them, but for those you all, if you belong to one of the libraries, I must say you've got to be so proud. It is such a delight to be able to work with them all. They work together so very well. You are truly lucky. And wherever you are, if you do not have your library card, go get it. You most likely have an incredible treasure right there. Do renew that. Check out Dr. Nancy Bristow's book, if you, or any of the other resources that are available. And feel free to stay on in the kind of post conversation where we're going to address a couple more of the questions. Again, thank you all so very much for joining us for our conversation. All right, so I think we do have a couple more. Thank you for those of you who are staying on. Man, there's a lot of you, 150 plus of you who are staying on with us. That's delightful. Wow. All right, we've answered Jerrica's question or statement right there. Dean Dunn asks, are there any records of mental health consequences of the pandemic?
It's such a great question. And I think we know much less than I wish we did, but it's very clear that mental health was often a sequela. It was often a consequence of this pandemic, that this particular illness would lead to depression for many people. Sometimes I suppose it was situational because terrible things were happening, right? We're in the midst of war, with midst of a global pandemic, and we all know how difficult that is to manage, but also that there seemed to be a physiological connection to mental health. And so a lot of mental health trouble in the aftermath. I think one of the things that we didn't understand then was post-traumatic stress disorder. And I think of the caregivers, and this was a very traumatic illness to witness. It was an ugly disease, be blunt. I won't go into the grossness of it, but trust me, it was an awful thing to see. And so we don't have an awareness. And so there's not a recording of that. And it's one of the things I wish, if I could go back in time, it's one of the things I'd like to know more about. It's a wonderful question. And I like the way you framed it, because I think it's one of the things we can be thinking about now. That's something we can do better, I think, than they did in 1918. And that's to really attend to the well-being of those of us in our communities who have suffered, who've gone through loss, who've been sick themselves, and having have the space to listen to them, to feel for them and with them, I think will be a really important role that all of us can play. As we come eventually into the aftermath of this. So I really appreciate that question.
Lindsay asked, were schools still in session in the 1918 pandemic because they didn't have the ability to do online school? They were in session, and then at times they were not in session, somewhere upwards of, and we gave the example with the Kansas letters, upwards of a month for some schools. So it really does just depend upon your different community. Lovely follow-up. Thanks for that.
And Chicago and New York did not close their schools because they believed, given the population and the large number of recently arrived immigrants in particular, that the best way to get public health information out to the public was through the school children who were English speakers. And so both of those large school districts decided to stay open because they thought that they could do better public health education through those school districts than they could if they closed them down. Very controversial, always a huge debate in every community about whether to close or stay open, but it was for a much more finite length of time. So it made it possible to close down. The other thing is, for many communities, it was during the winter holiday. It might have fallen over the Christmas New Year's period. Often that was when some of the worst wave, or they could be closed and then extended a couple of weeks because they were already going to be on holiday.
Yeah. So a teacher asked about the resource. This is the copy of it right here. So you can email education@theworldwar.org. And Beth Cornegay, we were prepared for a portion of this question about orphans. We didn't have a chance to really dig into that very specifically. Feel free to email specifically, or if someone else has a question about this, to education@theworldwar.org. Cherie Kelly did some very specific deep dives for you in some of this, and we would love to share that with you as well. So thank you for those questions. Rimsie, I think you had a couple of other questions as well.
I do. One of them is, what was the overall effect of the pandemic in 1918 on the U.S. economy? Was it as bad as now, or?
Such a hard one, because you can't separate out the war and the pandemic. So you have the demobilization from the war, and we have what was always described as a post-war recession. And now we're all asking ourselves, to what extent was that a post-war, post-pandemic recession? In other words, what role did the pandemic play? And I don't think we know the answer to that question yet, but it's a really important one. One thing that, again, is really different is things just weren't closed for as long of a time period. Mm-hmm. So the kinds of economic impacts were different than they are today, and much more of a localized economy, much less of an international economy. So again, it's a really different situation, and one about which I know very little.
Okay. And one question I have is, did President Wilson actually have any kind of a medical expert like Dr. Fauci, who he could get advice from or speak to journalists to try to explain what was going on?
Yeah, Dr. Rupert Blue, the Surgeon General, was instrumental. He was the primary voice for the spreading of public health information during the pandemic. And then that would be complemented by state and local public health leadership. The thing that's so strange about Wilson is that he literally never speaks about it to the American public. So he may be getting information, but he's certainly not sharing it. He is getting information because he talks with people about whether to cancel the Liberty Loan, whether to slow troop movements, but he's unwilling to slow down because the war is in its closing stages and he is determined to get the war done.
Okay.
But here's a really good example of how, right, Surgeon General Blue doesn't necessarily use Woodrow Wilson as the speaking point. He is going to he's going straight to journalists to share this information, or it may be that they are going to him. A really good question from one of our participants. And I would love to ask this question, and Nancy, it's gonna have to be to you. It was the very first question we got. Mary Lancaster, I believe you're still on. Thank you so much for that. So she asked this very specific question. So when we say 675,000 died then, of course, that is just 48 states, correct? What about in other US territories? I assume those were added somewhere else. And of course, we didn't have Hawaii and Alaska. Great question. I'm gonna start by saying we had the real honor to work with the Anchorage Museum over the summer. And we had an expert who is also from a tribe as well who spoke to this specifically. You can find out more about that lecture. Again, go to our YouTube channel, just type in FLU and it will pop up. And you can find out more about the Alaska experience. That is just the resource I can give that is a lot more comprehensive than what I could speak to. But Nancy, you know a lot more about this than I do.
Well, and it's a great question. And again, one of the things that's really hard is the record keeping was different in 1918 than it is now. And as you showed us, right, each community is keeping track, but influenza wasn't even a reportable disease when the pandemic begins. So the numbers are really, the 675,000, to be clear, is a, I won't say complete guess, but it's really a guesstimate, as are the worldwide figures. We just don't know for sure, but you're absolutely right that we're talking about the United States as it was configured at that time. It's not including the Philippines, Puerto Rico, Cuba, these places that were actually at that point had been annexed by the United States or were American colonies. Those are not, I assume, included in those figures, but it's a great question. I'm not sure I know. The other thing I was going to say is the figure 675 needs to be handled with care because in any given traditional year, more than 100,000 people would have died of influenza anyway. So it's about 550,000 excess deaths. So about 500,000 people die more than would have normally died from the flu. So again, the numbers are really sketchy. They're best guesses. And people have done really hard work to make good guesses. But again, we don't have information from a lot of places.
Go ahead. I think, Rimsie, I think I cut you off before.
Okay. I was wondering, okay, as far as how COVID-19 has affected different demographic groups, such as race, income level, and age, did the same thing happen in 1918?
That's one of the things that's really hard to know because the record keeping was really problematic. So depending on which newspaper you read and which public health report you read, you can get arguments that say African-Americans died in higher numbers and African-Americans died in lower numbers. What we do know is that access to healthcare was deeply influenced by the Jim Crow system. So that we know that people of color in general didn't have the same access to emergency hospitals or to public nurses that would have been going door to door to help out families. We know that poor families without a social safety net were much more likely to end up hungry, maybe to end up homeless, to perhaps have to put children into orphanages even when the parents were still alive. So we don't have data on death rates that is secure enough to trust. And yet there do seem to be reports that suggest the Black community had a lower morbidity and mortality rate that some people suggest may be accurate enough to work with. And then you have to ask questions about, well, so what is that about? And there's all kinds of guesses having to do with segregation, having to do with rural populations, having to do with people already infected early in the cycle. We just don't know very much. So we just don't have the same good data. What we do know is that the experience of it was much harder if you're a person of color or a poor American or worst case scenario, both of those things. The tribal communities, by the way, also suffered very badly. Mm-hmm. And that we know pretty definitively.
Okay. There was a great question from Dan here about how did the rapid onset of the disease in otherwise young, healthy adults end of life symptoms impact people's fear in 1918. Again, that's a really difficult thing to address because like today where we've got our pandemic and a variety of other things that are all kind of occurring at the same time, you have this pandemic, but you also have this, again, global catastrophic war, this fear of socialism, the rise of the Red Scare, all of these things are kind of intermingling, political, economic, social. All of those things might be contributing to people's fear. And so that's a really good question and a difficult one to answer. There's also a question from Will, who is joining us on Facebook Live, who said, nursing, who is asking a question about nursing. How did nursing change as a consequence of the 1918 pandemic? And I'm first just going to say some of it is going to be because of all of the tremendous changes that occur in nursing because of World War I. I want to expand that question just a little bit, because that is a moment that vastly changes the profession. I was very lucky to work with KU Medical Center and George Thompson to help bring a symposium. Again, we've got, I think, two lectures on the website, on the YouTube channel, that looks very specifically and unpacks some of this. That's my short answer. A lot of my answers are just, there's another expert you can really do a deep dive with at our YouTube channel, but Nancy Bristow, you've got more answers.
Well, and mine is actually a higher level answer. So it's less about the practice of nursing than it is about the status of the profession and women's experiences as nurses. One of the things that's really important to remember is that gender norms were much stricter in 1918. And so nursing was almost exclusively a female profession, and medicine doctoring was almost exclusively medical profession at that historical moment. So for physicians, this was a disastrous episode, really crushing to professional pride for some of the physicians, because they can't do what they're supposed to do, which is fix it, stop it, cure people. So for many people, it's really a disillusioning and depressing situation. Whereas for nurses, it's fascinating to read letters, diaries, school yearbooks from nursing schools, where they'll talk about, you know, so awful to see the sick people, but then after work, we had jolly good times. Or it was really awful, but it sure felt good to make good as a nurse. Or I really feel like a woman has arrived. They could feel good about what they were doing. They were fulfilling their role as a nurse, and they were fulfilling their role as a woman through that nursing. So for many nurses and for the nursing profession, it was a real a boost in a sense for them professionally. And they had just a very different sort of overarching experience of what they did and what happened during the pandemic. I think they leave the war and the pandemic combined with much higher status. They're really celebrated. Nurses who die are talked about as being just as brave as the soldiers in the trenches. And so there really is a fair amount of public, cultural, and obviously also political status that's gained as a result of the war and the pandemic together.
Kiana Smith asks, was pandemic denial a thing in 1918, the way that COVID denial is a thing today? Were there people who insisted that the flu was a hoax? From a museum memorial perspective, I don't have any archival sources that suggest that. I do have, we've got resources that do say that people didn't want to, they didn't want to abide by ordinances, and that those same kind of tensions that arise about, you know, where do you, just priorities, and it's economics, right? Where do you take the opportunity cost? But I don't have any evidences, any archival evidence. And it looks like, yeah, Nancy?
No, the one thing that you do see, there's one population, for Christian Scientists, actually, they believe that it's not a hoax, but they believe that it's being caused, that the fear itself is causing the illness, because they understand. And here I'll be very careful because I'm not a Christian Scientist, but they use the language that, right, Christian Science is, it's Christ Scientist is the church's name, right? And so the belief has to do with that having the right relationship with God, which is a very studied relationship, is how one stays healthy. And so it's because that relationship is flawed, that people aren't in the right mindset with God, that's what causes illness. And so they believe that all the public health measures are actually making people worse, that the wearing of masks is causing people to be fearful, which is causing them to get sick. And I had letters, for instance, between a mother and a son, or things published in the Christian Science Monitor, and published also in local newspapers, about the resistance of Christian Scientists to the restrictions and their belief that all those restrictions were only making things worse. But that's a very small population with a very distinctive theology that led them to those perspectives.
Alan Broom asked the question, at some point would love to hear what preventative efforts were different in 1918 versus now. I would say potentially one of them that was effective that we have come back to is this desire to be back outside and be in open spaces. I think all of us have experienced a lot more time in our city, national, state parks recently, and those were celebrated and new at the time. So I think that there was a greater emphasis on kind of being an outdoorsman or an outdoors woman back at the time, which we are coming back to. That's one of the few things that I might be able to go to as far as preventative efforts. There's some interesting things that folks do with food as well that may not have been quite as effective in trying to prevent the flu. They also encouraged you not to overeat, not to overdrink. So both of those are probably sound, not necessarily, again, against the flu pandemic. They did also suggest to not kiss people you didn't know all that well. So again, effective, but I don't know if that is, that's not really speaking exactly to your, exactly to your question.
Yeah. And the other thing that's going on, right, is this is the era of patent medicines, right? So things that the week before the Spanish flu arrives is being sold as something that will ease your joint pain. When the flu hits, suddenly it's being sold to solve that's going to cure influenza or it's going to make you get better quickly. And there's just scads of these newspaper articles or advertisements, for instance, about all these different things that will save you from the flu, which of course didn't. And then the folk traditions that Lora was speaking to earlier, there is the largest array from breathing in the fumes of boiling red peppers to asafoetida necklaces to a diet filled with only onion too, and you could go on and on and on with the things that people, and who knows, again, I'm not in a position to know for sure what did and didn't help, because part of course is going to be psychological, and did the fact that you were able to do something make you feel a little bit better? I don't know. So I won't poo-poo what people chose to do. If it made them feel a little bit more hopeful and less depressed, go for that onion diet if you need to. Right. Of course, now you can do that because without your sense of smell, you can go ahead and eat an onion, right? Sorry, my nephew had COVID and lost his sense of taste and smell and sent me a video of him eating a raw onion, a whole thing. It was so awful, but he could, so he was proving just how sick he was by sending us this video. But they were doing that in 1918 too.
Now, not sending videos. They were not sending videos in 1918, but eating onions, absolutely. And if you want to find that onion soup recipe, that is available on our online collections database. You just look up Allied Cookery. I know all of our cookbooks, all of our recipes. There's a really great tamale recipe as well, if you really start doing your digging in our online collections database. But the cookbook that the onion soup comes from, Allied Cookery, is really delightful. We also have an online exhibition called Warfare. It's a culinary exploration of World War I. And if you need a gluten-free cupcake, a chocolate cupcake recipe, we have you covered. But it is almost 30 minutes past time. So Nancy, I cannot begin to thank you enough for sharing your expertise, your time, your humor with us this evening.
Lora, thank you. You know, anything I can do for the public libraries, I'm always available. And I really mean that. The public libraries and the librarians that run them are a national and local treasure, as is the World War I Memorial and Museum. So again, it's just an honor and privilege to be with all of you and have a chance to talk about these things that all of us are thinking about and worrying about. And having the chance to be together, I think it lifts the spirits a bit. So thank you very much for including me.
Thank you. And Rimsie, thank you so much, not only for being a part of the conversation and kind of bringing the spine of our questions, but also for the work that you do as a journalist in the community. As a historian, I can say it is so important to have these stories, to have that facts and information that is published in communities around the nation. So thank you so very much for what you are doing at the Platte County Citizen.
Thank you very much.
And to all of you who are listening, again, thank you. I'm actually gonna give the last word to an epidemiologist I know, Dr. John Cafardi. So to those of you who have asked for other good information, the last word goes to an epidemiologist in Cincinnati, Ohio, who suggests these three things. Avoid the three C's: crowded, closed spaces with poor ventilation, crowded places with many people nearby, and close contact settings, such as close range conversations. it's the type of thing that you could have seen in a chromolithography ad back in World War I in so many ways, but good advice stands the test of time. Ladies and gentlemen, again, thank you so much for joining us, whether it's live or in the recording. We really value being a part of your lives and conversation. Have a wonderful, wonderful evening.
Thank you. And stay healthy. And